Good morning. My name is Laura Vogt. I am the curator of education here at your National World War I Museum and Memorial, located right here in Kansas City, Missouri, where it's been since 1926. And it is a genuine honor to welcome you back, or welcome you for the first time to what is our fifth centennial symposium series. And with that, we will begin with our kickoff speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to introduce Dr. Geoffrey Wawro, who is Professor of History and Director of the Military History Center at the University of North Texas. He was previously Professor of Strategic Studies at the United States Naval War College. Wawro is the author of six books, including his most recent, Sons of Freedom, The Forgotten American Soldiers Who Defeated Germany in World War I, which he'll be addressing this morning. He's also published articles in the Wall Street Journal, the Naval War College Review, as well as op-eds in the LA Times, New York Post, and his most recent, which you might have caught just a week or two ago, in the New York Times. He's won several prizes, including the Austrian Cultural Institute Prize and the Society for Military History Mankato Prize for excellence in the writing of military history. You can purchase his book during lunch today. There's going to be a book signing, and I think he's going to join us. And from 2000 to 2009, Wawro anchored various shows for the History Channel. Today, he continues to work as an on-camera expert for Discovery, Smithsonian, American Heroes, National Geographic, Netflix, other channels, including our YouTube channel right here today on this stage. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me in welcoming Dr. Geoffrey Wawro.
Well, thank you all for coming. When I started doing the research for this book, one of the things that struck me first of all was just the sheer variety of Americans who went to fight in this war. Fast Eddie Rickenbacker, who was in four Indianapolis 500 races before the war, was chosen to be General Pershing's chauffeur, found the job to be too tedious, transferred to airplanes, and became America's greatest ace of World War I with 26 kills. Christy Maddie Mathewson, still statistically one of the top three pitchers ever to play baseball, and was put into a chemical warfare unit and was mortally wounded in a training exercise overseen by a guy named Branch Rickey, who went on to become the famous general manager of St. Louis Baseball Browns and the St. Louis Baseball Cardinals. Gorgeous George Sisler, who is a guy who had the highest career batting average, 367, Sisler had most hits in a single season, 257, a record that wasn't broken until Ichiro Suzuki did it in 2004. Grover Cleveland, old Pete Alexander, the Phillies pitcher, still in possession by most wins by a rookie starting pitcher, 25. He was gassed, shell-shocked, and rendered an alcoholic for the rest of his tragically shortened life. You know this guy, Ty Cobb. Highest career batting average, 367. He went over and arrived on the Western Front too late to join in the Battle of Meuse-Argonne. He would have been in an offensive in 1919 had there been one. The commanding officer in his unit said, "I only regret that Ty didn't arrive in time to slide into the Kaiser with his spikes high." George Halas, who went over and returned to found the Chicago Bears and coached them for 40 seasons. Gene Tunney, who twice beat Jack Dempsey, became world heavyweight champion after the war, was a Marine during World War I. Tommy Hitchcock Jr., the world's best polo player, a 10-goal player, considered best in the world. He joined the Lafayette Escadrille, dropped out of St. Paul's School in New Hampshire, and joined the Lafayette Escadrille. If you were a senator's son during World War I, your appearance in the trenches was more, not less likely. All four of Teddy Roosevelt's sons went. Ted Jr., Archie, Kermit, and Quentin. Quentin, the baby of the family, was shot down on Bastille Day 1918 in the Marne salient. The loss just absolutely devastated his father and doubtless contributed to TR's death just 6 months later. Harry Truman, despite being legally blind in one eye and nearly blind in the other, he was given command of a battery of field artillery in the Missouri National Guard. The iconic mayor of New York City, Fiorello LaGuardia, he left a safe seat in Congress to join the Army, was assigned to the Air Service, and flew on the Italian front. The guy next to him, believe it or not, that's the chairman of the Senate Watergate hearings, Sam Ervin from North Carolina. He fought at the Battle of Soissons in July 1918, was wounded, and came home to start a brilliant career in politics, as so many others did. Leverett Saltonstall, Everett Dirksen, Hugo Black, all veterans of World War I. Famous soldiers, sailors, and airmen went, like George S. Patton, who commanded a brigade of tanks in the Battle of Meuse-Argonne, was badly wounded on the first day. Douglas MacArthur, who commanded a brigade in the 42nd Rainbow Division, rose to command the division by the end of the war. Father of the United States Air Force, Billy Mitchell, led General Pershing's Air Service. The man who became Chief of Staff of the Army in World War II was Pershing's most indispensable staff officer during the war, George C. Marshall. Beside him is Wild Bill Donovan, who was one of the more redoubtable commanders in the Rainbow Division and wounded three times in World War I. Famous writers and poets went. William Faulkner left a dissolving love affair in Mississippi, and ever the Anglophile chose to join the Royal Air Force. He was still in flight school in Toronto when the war ended. Archibald MacLeish, the Pulitzer Prize-winning poet who wrote a great poem called The Silent Slain, which was the original title for my book until the publisher said it's just too morbid. He drove an ambulance, and driving an ambulance was one of the more dangerous occupations on the Western Front because you were having to go up in these rickety cars and collect the wounded under heavy shelling. Beside MacLeish is a photo of Ernest Hemingway and John Dos Passos. Dos Passos' book, Three Soldiers, is, to my mind, one of the better novels about World War I. Both of these men drove ambulances during World War I. Again, a very risky occupation. E.E. Cummings, the very experimental poet who worked, did all sorts of strange things with punctuation and syntax, he also drove an ambulance on the Western Front in World War I, was briefly arrested by the French police for corresponding with one of the French army mutineers. Famous journalists went, like Walter Lippmann, who worked in Pershing's intelligence section and helped Woodrow Wilson draft the 14 points. The most famous sports writer of the era, Grantland Rice, famous for all kinds of phrases like, it's not whether you win or lose, it's how you play the game. He also served in the AEF. Famous businessmen went. Howard Deering Johnson went over, fought in World War I, returned to found the restaurant chain with its 28 flavors of ice cream. Jay Hormel went over and was, because of his expertise in meatpacking, was assigned to the supply service where he innovated in the freezing, packing, boning, and shipping of meat to the doughboys on the Western Front. Stephen Bechtel on the motorcycle fought on the Western Front, returned to expand the family construction business in San Francisco. Frederick Weyerhaeuser did the same with a family lumber business. Famous actors went. Humphrey Bogart was in the U.S. Navy, bringing soldiers home from the Western Front at the end of the war. Walt Disney, very young, joined and drove an ambulance on the Western Front. The guy with a dog in his lap is not famous. That's Corporal Lee Duncan. After the Battle of Saint-Mihiel in September of 1918, he was assigned to drive around the salient looking for suitable ground for an airstrip. And he found the ground for the airstrip, and next to it, a German trench with a bunch of abandoned puppies. He took all eight of them home to Los Angeles after the war, and he named one of them Rin Tin Tin. So why were all these Why were all these men and dogs there? They were there because in 1917, the year America joined the war, the Entente was, which is, of course, Britain, France, Italy, Russia. The Entente is in crisis. And they're being direly pressed on all sides by the Central Powers, Germany, Austria-Hungary. And they're undergoing a severe manpower crisis. And for them, there seems to be no way to win this war. The French army is undergoing a severe manpower crisis. They've lost 3 million casualties since 1914. The French army is losing an average of 900 killed and 1,200 wounded every day of this 1,500-day war. So the French are feeling that they've scraped the bottom of the demographic barrel. And so in 1917, they've dismissed Marshal Joseph Joffre, the victor of the Marne, and replaced him with a relatively young thruster by the name of Robert Nivelle. And Nivelle designs this great offensive, the Nivelle Offensive, which he says will, at a cost of fewer than 10,000 casualties, which is nothing by Great War standards, that he's going to defeat the German army. And the Nivelle Offensive founders immediately in April, May 1917. It generates something like 200,000 French casualties. And as a result, the French army mutinies. The poilu, which means bearded ones. Oddly, none of these guys have a beard, but they were known as the bearded ones because they lived in the trenches and didn't shave. The poilus mutiny, 49 of France's 113 combat divisions refused to go over the top. They say, we'll defend the trenches, but we won't engage in any more offensives. So the attacking spirit of the French army is utterly broken in 1917, and it never recovers. They bring in Marshal Philippe, general at the time, Philippe Pétain, to replace Nivelle, and his solution is to assure the French that they won't have to attack until all German opposition has been destroyed by artillery, and by the British on one flank and the Americans on the other. So the French are absolutely wilting in 1917. The Russians, and this is a rare colorized photo of Russian troops, the Russians have suffered 5 million casualties by 1917. And Russia is dropping out of the war. They've got tons of manpower, but they lack essential materiel. And meanwhile, you have a revolution brewing inside Russia. In February of 1917, the Tsar abdicates, is replaced by a provisional government headed by Alexander Kerensky. And Kerensky, to keep Russia in the war, to buck up morale, to reassure the Allies, launches this thing called the Kerensky Offensive in July of 1917, which is expected to push the Austrians and Germans back, and the opposite happens. Here we have this iconic picture of Russians not attacking the Germans and Austrians, but Russians running from the Germans and Austrians. This is the rout of the Kerensky Offensive. After some early gains, the Germans counterattack, and they're thrown back. And the failure of the Kerensky Offensive leads to big gains for Lenin and the Bolsheviks, who essentially promised the Russian mujiks, the Russian infantry, bread, land, peace, if they'll only exit the war. And so in the course of this Bolshevik revolution in the autumn of 1917, Lenin is able to remove Russia from the war. And with it, 223 combat divisions, half of the Allied strength, and most of the Allied reserve strength. And then, at the same time as the Bolshevik revolution is happening, the Germans apply the methods they had used so effectually against the Russians, against the Italians at the Battle of Caporetto, October, November 1917. And this is an image of German infantry corralling Italian prisoners. Now imagine the Battle of Caporetto, using these new infiltration tactics, storm troop tactics that the Germans had unveiled against the Russians. at the Battle of Riga in September of 1917. They take 250, they inflict 250,000 casualties, 250,000 casualties on the Italians, and capture, just as importantly, 3,000 Italian guns, meaning that all the artillery production in Britain going forward is going to go toward replacing all of these surrendered Italian guns. So it's going to slow down the Allied war effort on the Western Front, but it also exposes yet another flank. The British and French are going to have to send down combat divisions desperately needed against the Germans on the Western Front to backstop the Italians. The British, too, were dwindling. By 1917, the British have 2 million casualties. And there's growing civil-military tension between the Prime Minister, David Lloyd George, and the commander of the BEF, the British Expeditionary Force, the British Army on the Western Front. As, you know, Lloyd George, even though he has, unlike the French, who have literally no reserve manpower, they're totally reliant on the 200 or so teenagers that become military age every year. They don't have anybody else to sort of scrape up, anybody who's been passed over in earlier drafts. They're all dead or wounded. The British have 9 million able-bodied people they can still draft, but Lloyd George won't draft them because he calls Haig the military Moloch, Moloch being the Canaanite god who consumed his enemies with fire. Haig, Lloyd George says, has smothered the British army in mud and blood. So they have this reserve manpower, but they won't use it. They won't give it to the BEF for fear that Haig will lose it in offensives like the Somme, where he lost half a million men in 1916, or Passchendaele, where he loses 400,000 men in 1917. So the British also are either not, they're not reinforcing troops on the Western, divisions of the Western Front. They have 62 divisions on the Western Front holding holding a quarter of the length of the Western Front. And that number is projected in the course of 1918 to fall to as few as 28 divisions, because Haig doesn't, because Lloyd George will not reinforce Haig. And meanwhile, they've got 8 divisions in the UK, they've got a dozen divisions in the Middle East. So they've got divisions in places, they've got a half dozen divisions in the Balkans. They've got divisions in places that aren't critical. And it's seen as a way to keep these troops out of Haig's hands. So Britain is really wobbling at this point. The Germans, meanwhile, are refining these infiltration tactics that they used so well against the Russians at Riga and against the Italians at Caporetto. Basically, they're called Hutier tactics, named for the German general Oskar Hutier, who used them in Riga in 1917. And basically, you get this massive concentration of guns that you mass stealthily. You bring the guns up at night. You keep them under cover in camouflage. And you mass them in areas the enemy is not expecting. And you do the same thing with these assault divisions that are trained in new tactics. Chiefly, that the new tactics are that they subdivide into small units. They're differently equipped, submachine guns, pistols, daggers, grenades, light machine guns. And they follow something called a creeping or rolling barrage, keeping to within almost right up to the envelope where it is no longer safe to follow a creeping barrage. Very hard to do. You know, you're trying to keep within 50 meters of it. So you're just beyond the explosive radius of these advancing shells. And that means you can sprint into the enemy trench before the enemy can come back up from the dugouts and man their guns. So they've trained in these new tactics, they've tried them out, and they're going to bring unprecedented strength. The problem for the Allies, and this is again getting to the point how the U.S. wins World War I, the problem for the Allies is, you know, the Germans had 150 divisions on the Western Front in 1917 against 170 French and British divisions. They got 100 divisions on the Eastern Front. They're going to be able to bring at least 80 of these divisions from east to west for a crushing offensive. 3 million German troops against 2 million Allied troops in 1918 with something like 8,000 guns, giving them crushing superiority in all calibers. So this is what the nightmare scenario that the Allies are looking at. They're out of reserve power. They've lost the Russians. The only hope they have is the Americans, but the American army is nowhere to be found. That's why, because the U.S. doesn't declare war until April 1917. That's why France dispatches, right after the U.S. declaration of war, France dispatches its most famous soldier, Marshal Joseph Joffre, seen here at Grant's tomb. And the guy looking rather uncomfortable is Leonard Wood, sitting there, who was projected to be the commander of the American Army, but because he was a Republican, Wilson was a Democrat, they didn't get along, he was sidelined for the entire war. And I just want to read you, when I started the research for this book, I started, oddly enough, in French archives at the Chateau of Vincennes, and one of the first documents I came across was top secret instructions from the French government to Joffre when he went to America in April, May 1917. And this is what they said, among other things. English army at maximum strength and weakening. French army resources exhausted. In 1917, France will fight its last campaign at full power. Russian reserves of 2 million men may never be called due to revolution there. Only U.S. intervention can compensate for Russia's defeat and maintain the military power of the coalition. The American reservoir must replace the Russian reservoir. And then, on another research trip, I was in the Houses of Parliament archive in London. And in the Lloyd George papers, I came across this memo from Morris Hankey, who is a senior policy advisor to Lloyd George, who was telling the British War Cabinet in January 1918, quote, only the Americans can deliver the knockout punch. Without the Americans, we'll have only stalemate and an inconclusive and unstable peace. But, you know, could the Americans deliver the knockout punch? That was the question. The American army in 1917 was pretty weak. I mean, we had a regular army strength of 120,000 men. We had 80,000 in the reserves. There were 8,000 Marines, so that was a total of 208,000. And to this you could add 400,000 indifferently trained National Guardsmen, for a grand total of 600,000 men, give or take, at a time when the Allied armies on the Western Front were multi-million man armies, at a time when the Central Powers were deploying 10 million troops. At maximum strength, we were at 600,000. And we were pretty ineffectual. We sent the 10,000-man punitive expedition commanded by General John J. Pershing into Mexico after Pancho Villa raided Columbus, New Mexico, and killed 23 Americans in 1916. And it was a total flop. It eventually pulls in something like 120,000 personnel, and yet we're basically milling around in Chihuahua with strict rules of engagement, looking for Pancho Villa, nothing happens. It's a huge embarrassment. And so we have in the summer of 1917, Congress, after the declaration of war in April, in May, Congress puts forward this Selective Service Act, and 500,000 Americans are drafted and trained immediately, and 570,000 more will be drafted, trained, and available by May of 1918. So we'll have a million man army trained and ready. Of the officers who fought in World War I, well over 90% were recruited and educated, trained in 1917, 1918. These were the original 90-day wonders. So this army is slapped together on the fly and shipped quickly over to France. Now the Germans do strike with these new stormtroop infiltration tactics in March of 1918. At which point the Americans aren't even there. We send over four divisions in the winter of 1917-18, who are involved entirely in training, learning the routines of trench warfare, learning how to fight in open warfare when the trench lines are broken. But this takes months. And the weather is foul. It's the coldest winter in history, in recent history. And the Germans strike in March of 1918. Operation Michael here And they capture more terrain in 4 days here, 1,200 square miles, than the French and British have captured in the entire war on the Western Front. And in March, and then in April, they attack up here, Operation Georgette. And they absolutely crush the British. They destroy this British Fifth Army in Operation Michael, and they push nearly take, they're trying up here, pushing in Flanders to push the British into the sea. Haig issues his famous backs to the wall bulletin in April of 1918 when he says our British backs are to the wall. And it's Ludendorff, who's, you know, Hindenburg's principal deputy. His idea is to, he sees the British as the toughest opponent on the Western Front. He sees French morale as shaky. If he can drive the British into the sea, if he can take Calais, Dunkirk, the principal ports on the Channel, and isolate the British, destroy the French, he reckons, will fall. Well, the British do hold. Ludendorff then turns his attention to the French and attacks with Operation Blücher down here, where he begins in May, he begins pushing the French hard. And initially this is just seen as a diversion to try to shift dwindling Allied reserves down to the French sector so that he can then renew the attack and push the British into the sea. But his success is overwhelming in this Operation Blücher. He basically destroys an estimated half the strength of the French army in the Western Front, most of which dissolves and flees before this German onslaught. The American troops who are leaving their camps for the first time and marching to the front, such as the emergency, the Germans, you know, they cross the Aisne, they cross the Weser in this pocket here. And they cross the Aisne River, they cross the Weser, and they get all the way down to the Marne River here where they're 50. They're just 50 miles from Paris. And so the Americans are forced to send several divisions out of their training camps. Remember, American divisions are three times the size of a French division. They're 28,000 men. So when you say several American divisions, you have to, you know, say that's like the equivalent of a dozen French divisions. And they send them up to help stem the onslaught. And the scenes I describe in the book, the French army is retreating from the front, and they're all yelling, la guerre est finie, fini. They say fini so often, what are you doing here? Go back, the war is over. So often that fini becomes American army slang during the war, you know, for the ammo is fini, the food is fini, the corned beef is fini. So the troops start using fini. And as slang, they hear this so often from the French. So I think that's an important point, that there was a real morale collapse inside the French army. And it's not, they haven't been destroyed physically by the Germans, they've been destroyed mentally. And so that points to the significance of the Battle of Belleau Wood, which was waged for most of the month of June 1918. When the Marines and the Doughboys deploy into Belleau Wood to stop the German onslaught. Here's a picture of Marines at Belleau Wood. And suffer 9,000 casualties. You know, and the fighting is, you see in this image, it's like hand to hand in this wood where there's like no straight lines and people are walking into German fire, walking into German trenches. The combat, nobody gets a hot meal for 2 or 3 weeks. Nobody even takes their shoes off for 2 or 3 weeks. But the reason it's such an important battle is because you can see, I looked for a better image and this couldn't find one. The Marne River bends around to the south here, and Belleau Wood sits in this corridor where there's no river line blocking the advance on Paris. Meaning that if the Germans can break through here, they get a straight shot at Paris, but also they outflank all the defenders behind the Marne River. So it was crucial to hold it. And that's why the fighting was so vicious. And the Germans, you know, I found in the archives, in the Bavarian War Archive in Munich, you know, instructions from Ludendorff to the German commanders in Belleau Wood saying, you need to treat the Americans really savagely, really roughly, because if we can defeat the Americans there, they'll be demoralized, they won't continue to come over, and we can keep the Americans out of the war. And but the Americans gave as good as they got in the wood and eventually secure it, thus saving the Marne River line and slowing this German descent on Paris. And then the Germans, in July of 1918, they make one last attempt to break through, throwing everything they've got into this attack from, basically in this area here, from Chateau Thierry over to Reims, where they're pushing down, again, trying to break through, trying to take Paris. The Germans estimate that if they can take Paris, the war is over. French morale will completely collapse. French war industry, which is clustered in the suburbs around Paris, will be stifled. And so they're waging everything. And this is where, something like 10 U.S. divisions, fight, really ably against the Germans, joining with French divisions as well. And this is where the U.S. 3rd Division earns its nickname, the Rock of the Marne, because they're deployed along the Marne River at Chateau Thierry, and they fight along the water's edge. They don't give ground the way the French and British were in this elastic defense that had been pioneered by the Germans. They fight like right at the water's edge. They inflict punishing casualties. It's described in the book just how shocked the Germans were at this kind of resistance. And again, by a conscript army. These troops were all rookies. They had all been hastened into battle. And they fought with incredible courage. So this is a picture of some of the terrain around Chateau Thierry. There was some swampy ground on the south bank of the Marne, and then there were forests that grew right up to the water's edge, and you had the Germans infiltrating across on pontoon bridges and then running into this American resistance on the south bank of the river. And then ensues the 100 Days Offensive, where General Ferdinand Foch, the Allied Generalissimo, who is technically in charge of all the Allied armies, the Belgians, the British, the French, the Americans, the Italians, he organizes this synchronized offensive where all of the Allied armies will attack at the same time to try to push the Germans back and prevent the Germans from reinforcing any one sector, because they'll be attacked in all sectors at once. And this is where the American role is absolutely crucial, because they're attacking what's known as the vital pivot of the whole German position, this area in the Meuse-Argonne. Now, why is it the vital pivot? Well, because the German position on the Western Front is supplied by this major railway which runs from Metz through Sedan, Mezières, on up to Lille, and then there's an important branch up to Bruges. This one railway here conveys over half of all the men and materiel on the German side. And with it, they can move 5 divisions every 24 hours anywhere they want. Without it, they can move less than 1 division in 24 hours and all of the required materiel, provisions, and everything else. So it's crucial. Now, the Allies knew it. The thing is that this great bulge of German-occupied France and Belgium narrows temptingly here above Verdun. And so the Allies knew if we can attack from Verdun and cut the German rails at Sedan, we can make it untenable for them to remain in France and Belgium. And the French had tried. They lost this ground in 1914. They tried in 1915. They tried in 1916 during the Battle of Verdun. And they had really heavy casualties trying to take it. And so eventually they give up, realizing that the Germans have carved this terrain into some really formidable defensive positions, and the human cost is too high. So they continue to push. They push from here, but here the Germans have all kinds of strategic depth. They can give ground anywhere along here and just keep pulling back to the Meuse, to the Moselle, to the Rhine. But here they can't give ground. There's no strategic depth. They have to hold in these positions. So Pershing, he was under tremendous pressure from Haig, from Pétain, the commander of the French army, from Foch, the French and general staff chief and allied generalissimo, to amalgamate his army into their armies, to use American troops as replacements for British casualties, for French casualties. And Pershing insists on having an independent U.S. army, and he's backed by President Wilson in this. And he insists on having an independent American sector. And so he chooses the only sector available, which is this one down here. the Meuse-Argonne, with the Argonne Forest on one flank separating the American Army from the French Army on the other side, and the Meuse River on the other flank. And it's a really devilish sector, because the Hindenburg Line, which comes down, the length of German-occupied France and Belgium, in the Meuse-Argonne sector, it's known as the Chemin Stellung, the Chemin position. And it's basically three whaleback ridges running parallel, all of them, facing the American front, all of them sculpted by the Germans into these concreted fortifications that are, really formidable. Here's just an example of one. That's the, this low-profile concrete bunker. You dug into the terrain, the Americans are going to come upon it before they even see it. There's going to be German machine guns, German field artillery, and there's three ridges like this. And it's impossible to flank these positions because you have the Argonne Forest on one flank, which is heavily fortified by the Germans, and you have the Meuse River on the other flank, heavily fortified by the Germans. The heights, the famous Meuse Heights, on the allow the Germans to mount guns and shell any American attempt to push through the Meuse-Argonne sector from the flank. So it's a really difficult job. And the combat in the Meuse-Argonne is absolutely brutal. As the Americans attack on September 26, they take this first line of fortifications at Montfaucon. Then they push forward to the Chemin at Romane, where the big American cemetery, where 26,000 Americans are buried, that still no U.S. president has ever visited. It's the biggest American cemetery in Europe. And after taking that, they have to push on to the next position, the Barricourt Heights. And then once they break through there, they're in a position finally to cross the Meuse River. And this was absolutely critical to winning the war. When I say how the U.S. won the world, won World War I, is because they're able to get across the Meuse River. The Germans had seen this as being an inviolable barrier. They had to hold the Meuse. If they would eventually yield it if they had to, but they then fall back to the Moselle, and then back to the Rhine, just as they did in World War II. But if you could get behind the Meuse and obviate it as a strategic barrier, then the Germans were finished, because they'd have to abandon the Meuse and they'd have to retreat back to the east. But once the Americans get over the Meuse in strength, and remember, this is just the U.S. First Army what we're looking at here. Once they get behind this river, you've also got the U.S. Second Army, which is deploying further to the east opposite Metz, which is going to get across the Meuse and get in behind the Germans there. So once they do this on November 6, 1918, the Germans are effectively surrounded. And the British and French offensives, meanwhile, have lost steam. They made great headway in August, September 1918, but then they run into heavier German resistance. And it's often said that the German army was collapsing and everything else. Well, the German army was collapsing inwardly. The food wasn't good, and there was a sense of futility. But why was there a sense of futility? There was a sense of futility because of the American intervention. The certainty that you have a million American troops already fighting in France, and you have 3 million American troops projected for 1919, when the war is assumed that the war will drag into 1919, and there's going to be no way. And there's also just the fact that by 1918, the U.S. is economically dominating the war. By 1918, the U.S. has spent more in its first year of the war, its first and only year of the war, than Britain, which had been the paymaster of the Entente, had spent in the previous 3 years. The U.S. was building five times more ships than the British were by 1918. The U.S. was supplying half the aircraft on the Western Front by 1918. The U.S. was on track to have an air force of 25,000 planes and 100,000 trained pilots in time for this 1919 campaign. So you see, you can see that the between the pinkish color and the gray color, that's the front line on Armistice Day 1918. And you can see the British and French offensives have stalled, and they're really not making a lot of progress. The French are reluctant to attack. The only way that Pétain can keep the army together is by assuring that the troops that they will not have to attack until all enemy resistance has been destroyed. He coins this term, le feu tout, you know, firepower kills, will grind everything up, and then you'll advance once enemy resistance is broken. Well, this doesn't really help when the Germans are in concrete bunkers when they're dug in, and so the French are really lagging behind the British offensive on one flank and the American on the other. So when the war ends on Armistice Day, I mean, just look at that line. And I say, if you don't factor in the American intervention, how do the Allies win? I mean, how do they evict the Germans from France and Belgium? You have to carry the war into 1919. You have to look at a French army that is literally out of men. You have to look at a British army that still has reserve manpower. But I mean, we're hearing Lloyd George say in 1918 that if casualties continue, and remember the British and the French each lose 500,000 men in 1918, each. And so you're looking at a situation where Lloyd George says, if the killing continues at Haig's torrid pace, we will have social revolution in Britain. And you have a situation where the British are saying, okay, it's time to give up on the fighting on the Western Front. It's unwinnable. We might keep a fortified foothold on the continent around Amiens, this crucial rail junction connecting Flanders to the French army further south. So we might build our own version of the Hindenburg Line in order to keep a foothold on the continent. Or we might withdraw altogether and continue a maritime war against the Germans. But again, how do they win without the American intervention? That's the question. And certainly something that I encourage, I've been trying to find a grad student to do this, but I think the book that's really needed is a study of the actual manpower situations in Britain and the Dominions, in France. How were these powers going to find an army to go on into 1919? So I think, you know, the war ended so abruptly with the Kaiser abdicating and the German army dissolving that we don't really ponder what would have happened without the American intervention, an American intervention that contributed so much to that German implosion. So the doughboys themselves were, you know, remarkable, and I came across a great quote by Edward Streeter, who was the author of the popular Dear Mabel letters, Dear D-E-R-E, Mabel, M-A-B-L-E, because, you know, the average education of a doughboy in 1918 was if you were a native-born white American, it was 7 years. If you were a immigrant American, it was 4 years. If you were an African American, it was 3 years. So they have, all their letters were full of misspellings, and so the Dear Mabel letters. This was the Willie and Joe verse of World War I. And Streeter, about the doughboys, he said that they had that strange mixture of discontent and cheerfulness, stubbornness under discipline, and tractability under leadership, sentimentalism and repression, garrulous incoherence. The doughboys, Streeter said, were men used to taking things as they find them, vaguely understanding, caring less, grumbling by custom, cheerful by nature, ever anxious to be where they are not, ever anxious to be somewhere else when they get there, without thought of sacrifice, who have left the flag waving to those at home, who serve as a matter of course. I was just sort of blown away by these men, the dangers they faced, the conditions they lived in. Imagine I think one of them said that summer in France lasts for about 3 days in July or August, and then the rest of the time it's winter. And imagine being in, you know, northeastern France in October, November 1918 under a pelting rain. It rained all the time. Everybody's memoir, American, German, French, they talk about the rain, and cold rain at a time when, you know, flu and pneumonia are shooting through the ranks and people are being put into line ill. It's just the courage displayed was just tremendous, and a lot of these stories I tell in the book. And I just close with one quick story. After the war, they asked one of Teddy Roosevelt's sons. They said, why did you guys go over? You know, you could easily have got out of this war. I mean, look, there were so many, John Dos Passos in his novel, Three Soldiers, says they were running special trains to Washington so all the intellectuals could get out of fighting and get some safe government job. And there were lots of people that were eligible for the draft that, worked a safe billet behind the lines, like Joe Kennedy Sr., father of Jack Kennedy, who was 28 years old and, wangled a job in the offices of Bethlehem Steel in Boston so that he couldn't be drafted and sent to the front. So there were lots of people who did it. But they asked Ted Jr., they said, why'd you guys go? And he said, because Dad always told us that to lead is to serve. And thank you very much. I appreciate your attention today. And I'm happy to take any questions.
That's exactly it. Ladies and gentlemen, at this point, we would invite you to either microphone to ask some questions. And you all are a spectacular audience, and I already know that they are going to be questions and not statements. Thank you for kicking us off.
Thank you, Laura. Yeah, hello, Professor Wawro. I'm John Kuhn from the Command of General Staff College. We just finished teaching our students about these offensives up there at Fort Leavenworth. And I think we can all agree here, I see some of my colleagues up there, they'd probably be on the bus for this, that all those reserve divisions that the United States brings to the table as it mobilizes in 1917 and 1918 give the Allies hope. And once it's clear what their impact on the battlefield will be, remove hope for the militarist government of Germany under Hindenburg and Ludendorff. That said, the Americans are planning to win this thing in 1919, as you mentioned. Mm-hmm. So my question is, first off, I didn't hear you mention the Black Day of the German Army in August at Amiens, with the combined arms tactics with the tanks and the artillery that the British have. I did see a lot of liberated territory for the French and the British offensives. And I didn't hear an account of the casualty rate for the two-month Meuse-Argonne offensive or when those casualties occurred in the AAF. My views, I will let you, for full disclosure, are informed by the work of Sean Faulkner and his book, Pershing's Crusaders. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, the 125,000, I was going to go back to show you a map there, but I seem to have lost. Here we go. 125,000 casualties in the Battle of the Meuse-Argonne, 25,000 killed, 100,000 wounded, which was the highest. We had the highest monthly casualty rate in. In U.S. military history, and 36,000 a month compared to 6,000 a month in World War II. So as for liberated ground, it gets back to what I was saying earlier about how this is the vital pivot described by the Allies as the vital pivot of the German position. Described by the British war correspondent Charles Acourt Repington as the solar plexus of the whole German position in France. So you see, they can't retreat here. That's why the fighting is so stubborn in the Meuse-Argonne. That's why the Allies are constantly complaining about the lack of American progress, because the Germans will not yield an inch of ground, because the Germans are under instruction not to undertake elastic defense, not to retreat in the face of overwhelming fire, but to fight, hold their positions, and they actually launch counterattacks here, wasting precious, dwindling infantry. Whereas here, yeah, they have all this strategic depth. So yeah, they retreat, they retire to get beyond the range of British and French artillery, to take up new positions. And they can retire because they have this great bulge of German-occupied France. They can fall back a lot longer till they get to a critical river line like the Meuse, whereas the Meuse is right there. They're right on top of the Meuse, down in the Meuse-Argonne. So, the Americans, when Foch comes and yells at Pershing, and the book describes this, that was what I saw as being one of the great contributions of this book, is that it really contextualizes the American war effort. A lot of the books, all of the books I'd seen about the AEF tended to segregate the Meuse-Argonne in its own little place, and it was hard to relate it to the other battles on the Western Front, to the other battles in this 100 Days Offensive. And so I tried to show it in real time, what was happening, the arguments going on between American and Allied headquarters. And Foch is constantly yelling at Pershing, saying, get moving, make more progress, drive the Germans back further. Clemenceau is constantly trying to get Pershing fired, appealing directly to President Wilson in Washington, saying, you need a new commander, this guy has the slows. But in fact, he doesn't have the slows. It's just the fact that the Germans are holding this area so much more stoutly than they're holding the other areas where they are retreating in the face of overwhelming force, preparing to take up new lines further east. So, that's really what's going on there. And again, that explains this curiosity that we've got the highest monthly rate of casualties in U.S. military history, because there is simply no way to break through. There's no way to flank these positions, because you've got the Argonne on one flank, the Meuse on the other flank. They have to go straight through. Now, it was there's a lot of lessons learned from this campaign. There's a great deal of discomfort with the casualties sustained. There's a feeling that Pershing was a bit of a neophyte and that he was too beholden to this ideology of the offensive, of asserting, the need for vim and pep, as he put it, to, get people up and attacking. And a lot of officers were canned, blueyed, as they called, because they were sent to the Chateau of Blois on the Loire River for reclassification. So if you wouldn't attack, if you wouldn't take these kind of casualties, trying to break through these German fortifications with frontal assaults, you'd be canned. You'd be sent home in disgrace. So this is not to say that American tactics were refined. They weren't. They were really in their infancy. And it took a general like Hunter Liggett, who's one of Pershing's corps commanders, then he's given command of the U.S. First Army when they cross the Meuse and get behind the Germans. Liggett is operationally a much better soldier than Pershing. And he makes sure that they take the time to bring up loads of artillery to crush the German positions before they send the doughboys in, something that Pershing had hesitated to do because he was under such pressure to get moving by Haig, by Pétain, by Foch. And Liggett just says, I don't care. Liggett was a big guy. Pershing had famously almost sent him home when he canned a bunch of generals early on, and because Liggett was, really heavy set, and he campaigned with a cordon bleu chef and loved to eat, and people said, oh, he's fat, he's lazy, and Liggett always said, there's no fat above my collar. And Liggett was really one of the great generals of the war, and so he's the one who arranges this last great offensive, which kicks off on Halloween 1918. And results in crossing the Meuse, getting behind the Germans, pushing right up to Sedan, and forcing the Germans surrender. So yeah, I mean, yes, I did I answer the question? Yeah. Okay.
There was a thumbs up from the crowd on that one. We have time for two more questions, and I believe both gentlemen are already standing.
Great presentation.
Thank
Geoffrey,
you.
I'm Ted Hoosier. I'm the Secretary of the League of World War I Aviation Historians. So I'm an air war guy, right?
Yep.
Masterful, presentation about the ground war. And you talked about one thing that caught my attention, and it was the production of American naval ships. How did Britain look at that? Because before the war, they were terribly afraid of the German Navy, and here the Americans are coming with all these ships, although I don't know if they were, what type of ships, if they were just Liberty ships or what types of ships they were. Did Britain start feeling a threat at all in the bigger picture as this was coming to a close? And if you don't like the question, just bat it away.
Oh, no, sorry.
Well, I'm going to actually first interrupt and say thank you, because that's the best segue that we could possibly have for our next speaker as well. So, Dr. Wawro, back to you.
Well, the there was great tension between Britain and America, from 1914 on. And, I talk about in the early chapters of the book, Britain is the closest thing America has to a hereditary enemy. Britain had, we'd fought, obviously, the American Revolution, but then Britain, backs the Confederacy during the American Civil War. And we really had a feeling that, and then during World War I, when the U.S. is a neutral power, Britain, the British blockade acts against all U.S. trade with the Central Powers, or even neutrals in Europe like the Netherlands. Stopping American ships at sea, searching them, turning them back, seizing the mail bags, that sort of thing. And, American opinion is affrighted by all this. You've got these big Irish-American groups, a million Irish-Americans in New York, half a million Irish-Americans in Boston. So, big communities in politically vital states who hate the British. And Woodrow Wilson, throughout, before in the years before intervention, he thinks the British are using the blockade of on the high seas, but also the blockade of information. They're not letting any real information about what's really happening on the Western Front or on any front out to try to sort of tamp down the horror. But that leaves Americans with no idea what the war is really like. So he thinks the British are manipulating this whole situation so that they can then gather in German colonies, they can expand their empire, they can expand their global position after the war. So there's a great deal of rivalry right up to the war, and then during it itself. And I think the British are alarmed. Most of that tonnage that I'm talking about is mainly the kind of ships needed to transport troops and supplies over to the Western Front. Remember, in 1917-18, we're almost entirely reliant on the British. We don't have the hulls. The U.S. Merchant Marine in 1917 is the same size that it had been in 1812. And so we're entirely reliant on British and French shipping to get the army over there. But then we get into gear, we start building these modular ships that we can build in a matter of days. And then we start just churning out the hulls needed to move this big army, this 3 million man force with tanks, with aircraft, everything else for 1919. So the British are wary, and after the war, when you talk about, the rise of appeasement in Britain and France, it's a reaction to this economic mismatch. They simply don't have the resources to compete with all the Axis powers. When you think about the Washington and London naval disarmament conferences, it's a recognition by Britain in the late teens, early 20s, that they simply can't compete as a global power anymore.
All right, our last question is going to come from Jared Nichols.
Hey, sir, great presentation. So I've been doing a little bit of research on the AAF. I'm currently a student at the School of Advanced Military Studies. And I've ran across this quote. I kind of want to get your thoughts on it. It's from a paper written by James Rainey in Parameters Magazine. So the AAF succeeded not because of imaginative operations and tactics, nor because of qualitative superiority in open warfare, but rather by smothering German machine guns with American flesh. So I just kind of what your thoughts on that comment. I mean, you made a great qualitative account for the contribution to AAF, but about how they actually did fight. Was it really just they threw their bodies at machine guns and that's how we won the war?
Well, yeah, I mean, sad but true in a way. There were two great episodes of fighting in the Marne salient in June, July 1918. And there we basically are trying to, deal with the fallout of Operation Blücher, this big German pocket that had been driven to the line. And only the Americans have the manpower to crush it out. The French are involved in their Soissons offensive. The British are involved in their counteroffensive. So we attack that. And it's essentially, you know, in this very undulating salient, and the Germans have got machine guns in every fold of the ground. They're using eight-man stay-behind units that are very cleverly deployed in sort of checkerboard way. So there we're just trying to rub these things out, and we're sort of marching in and getting gunned down. And it's very hard to locate. And that's one of the big campaigns we're involved in. And then the other, obviously, is the Battle of Saint-Mihiel and the Meuse-Argonne. And those are quite different. But the Battle of Meuse-Argonne, that is essentially what happens. And it's for a number of reasons. Chief among them, the fact that Pershing sets this standard that people have to attack. They have to just overcome the horror of it all and just attack. And a lot, you know, you have this correspondence back from officers saying, we can attack. You know, the Germans are entrenched. The Germans are in concrete bunkers. The Germans have all this ground covered. And then Pershing will can that officer and replace him with someone. Someone who's very adept at this is MacArthur. MacArthur famously says when he's told to take the Côte de Châtillon, which is kind of the central core of the Kriemhilder Stellung. It's this height overlooking Romagne where the cemetery is. And he's told by Pershing, you know, take the Côte de Châtillon. He's a brigade commander. He's told by his divisional general, take the Côte de Châtillon. He says, yes, sir, I will take it at the cost of, if it takes 6,000 casualties, I'll take the Côte de Châtillon, and my name will be at the top of that list of 6,000 casualties. So MacArthur realizes the game, you know, that you have to be willing to take casualties. And to his credit, I mean, he's in the front line on some of these attacks. He's in the front rank. But that's what they have to do, is they have to just keep attacking and in order not to be canned by Pershing. And as I said, along comes Liggett, who begins to refine these tactics and begins to say that we will get sufficient field artillery forward to crush the German wire, crush these German pillboxes, allow the doughboys to attack with a measure of safety. But Pershing is always in a hurry, always feeling the heat. I talk a lot about his travails and how he ages visibly because he's under such pressure from Washington, from the Allied commanders to get the army moving. And so his idea is just to keep sending them and keep forcing these pessimistic generals to attack. You know, the very short memoirs of George C. Marshall about his World War I years speak of this too, about how the need to, at Chaumont, the American headquarters, constantly canning officers to try to get them forward, seeing pessimism as the cardinal sin, optimism as being required, optimism meaning the ability to overlook casualties and to keep pressing onward. But the result for the doughboys in the front line was, you know, just a parade of horrors.
Now, I know that some of you still have more questions for him, and I believe Dr. Wawro will be happy to take those during our break. I also know some of you want to purchase his book. The museum store right now is closed, so please don't go knock on the door. But online at www.theworldwar.org, the museum store is always open, so feel free to purchase your book there. Now, if you want to find out more information about that second question and the Navy in World War I, please be sure to be back in your seats promptly at 9:59, because we'll be starting at 10 a.m. Please join me in thanking Dr. Geoffrey Wawro.
Thank you.